We all search for that spark which fuels our desire to fully engage in our lives. We look for the courage to experience moments where we can come alive instead of watching life pass us by. You're listening to The Front Row Factor, leaving fear and insecurity behind by exploring stories of top performers that are living life in the front row. Get ready to stand up, step up, and live it up with your host, John Vroman.
Welcome, Front Row family. John Vroman here, and we are back with another exciting podcast interview for you, talking today to Sim Gluck from Israel. This guy is a longtime friend, and he is changing the world one game at a time. He and his partner, Ronen Gafni, founded the FreshBiz Game. I played this. It rocks. It's amazing. I literally played it in my basement with a small group of friends, and within hours, I could see how my thinking had already transformed. I talk more about that in the interview, but this is a guy whose training company focuses on fun, multidimensional winning, and smart thinking. He's working with companies all over the world. 35,000 people to date in 20 different countries, from business students to entrepreneurs to executives, have experienced this game. And he literally is shifting the way that we think about how we play life. This company was featured by Game Changers 500 alongside Whole Foods and Kickstarter and Zappos and some other amazing companies. He's also working the one-to-one donation strategy here, where they're donating one training kit for everyone that is sold. In this interview today, we talk about all sorts of fun things, talking about game-based learning versus gamification. We talk about creating enriching experiences, whether you're running a company or your mom and dad, or you just want to do this with people you love. We talk about how to play your action cards, what that means and how it can make a difference in your world starting today. How, get this is awesome, how access trumps ownership. We dig into that concept, and if you just want to roll a six, roll the dice 1,000 times, and how that concept can be applied to almost everything in your world. And finally, one that blew my mind was why you might not want to be called an expert. So there's so much within this this interview here. I have a blast with this guy. You're going to see we're really good buddies. We have a lot of history together. I love him to death, and I'm just excited to share him with the community. So ladies and gentlemen, buckle up for my interview with Mr. Sim Gluck. All right, Sim Gluck. Normally, we're chatting when you're in Israel, but dude, today you're in Princeton, New Jersey. What's up, buddy?
That is correct. I'm in Princeton for the next couple of weeks until I head back to Israel, and it's just beautiful being in the country and getting away a little bit and being with my family.
Yeah, man. We just, in our kind of warm-up to the call here today, we were chatting about your day, and you've got so much exciting stuff going on, and man, I'm excited for you on so many levels. This interview, by the way, I feel is a long time coming. I have been a raving fan. I'm not telling you anything you don't know, but I am telling our listeners something they probably don't know. And that is, I've been a raving fan of Sim Gluck's for as long as I can remember. And dude, I'm going to start with something today just to tell everybody. You absolutely changed my life years ago standing in the lobby of a hotel. And I know I've shared this story with you in different ways over the years, but we were having a conversation about about some of your religious practices, and you were talking about how during the month you would abstain in certain ways from certain activities, and I asked you about how tough that was to abstain, and you said, well, one of the great things about doing that is that when you eliminate something and you bring it back, it's like when it comes back, it's with tremendous joy that you have it back in your life, right? That started for me what was the 8 weeks to appreciation program, where I systematically eliminated things from my life that I thought I was learning to take for granted. And in doing so, gain better appreciation for those things. So whether it was TV or radio or anything, I learned the art of abstinence, and I credit you for that. And I've told that story 100 times. So dude, I just want to tell you and the world that you've changed my life.
Thank you for that. And it's so funny that that became something of epic proportions. I think that that's really the distinction between hearing a good idea and saying, this good idea is awesome and I want to build it into my life and my lifestyle. So it's really cool that you turned it into something special. And I remember that conversation, actually.
That's a great one. You might have had a totally different experience with that conversation, but it changed my life. So thanks.
Definitely.
So Sim, to bring everybody up to speed, can you give us a, you know, 2-minute-ish life story? And also, when you get to the present day, how about a highlight reel, man? What's going on? There's so much good happening. I know that'll be almost impossible to keep it to 60 seconds, but bring us from the early days to right now, a quick life story.
Yeah, sure. I guess to sum it up like this, I spent most of my life in the U.S. I, you know, went to college, did what everyone else did, had a really good family, have a really good family. And I started actually when I met Rachel. So we were young. I was about 22. Rachel's my wife now of about close to 15 years.
Wow.
Rachel had this wacky job where she was selling knives. And I just found that really fascinating. And I remember going with her on one of her appointments and just watching her sell $1,000. And we walked out the door and I said, wow, you know, I'm 21 years old. Tell me, how much money do you make from that? And she's like, I make half. I'm like, $500? Lunch is on you. And hook a brother up.
Right.
So she hooked me up, and Rachel and I basically pretty much worked, you know, with Cutco around college. We graduated. We became the New York City managers for the company for a bunch of years. We sold millions of dollars of product line. We had a team of about 500 to 600 sales reps every year that worked with us and for us. And it was wild and crazy. At some point, we got into self-development and coaching and training, and basically just, you know, decided to pretty much pick up and move to Israel. And that was a real epic change. And in Israel, just because I've always been just a passionate entrepreneur and someone who's just really all about helping people take their game up as much as possible, got into real estate there. I continued coaching over there. And about 5 years ago, I met my partner, Ronen Gafni. And the two of us basically co-founded FreshBiz. And for the past 5 years, we've just been on a world mission with our game and essentially with our training company, FreshBiz. And John, you know, you and I actually played the game. Like, just to give, I guess, context to it, my partner Ronen, he's brilliant, and essentially he spent about 5 years of his life creating a board game. And he did it because he just essentially felt that so many of the games out there that we've been all brought up playing are games that train us to be in fear. Fear of competition, fear of losing, fear of having less money, fear of being a failure, fear of being unsuccessful. And we carry that with us. So he wanted to create a game that's all about the new values in the new world and the new shared economy and the new world of entrepreneurship. So he created a game that's essentially, it's a time-based game that's all about collaboration, all about communication, all about how to maximize and leverage your resources. And I actually, you know, it's a brilliant game. And someone had invited me to go to a workshop and I played it. And it really blew my mind. I remember, you know, you and I have talked about this. It blew your mind also. And that's how we've really these past few years. But it didn't blow my mind. And then I went back to my life. It blew my mind and continued to work on my thinking. And I found that fascinating. I said, this is something powerful and I really want to get involved. So I did. I became a fellow trainer. And that was pretty cool. But when Ronen wanted to take it global, he basically gave me a phone call and I became co-founder with him. And I was just, that was my epic moment from God, if you will, really, you know, to go from, you know, a trainer to a co-founder. And really over these past 5 years, essentially we've taken our FreshBiz board game and we built a whole line of game-based trainings around it. Everything from a half day to a 2-day to a 6-month to a full day program and everything in between. We've taken over 50,000 people from across 25 countries through our training experiences, and we've really built it from scratch. We built it with, you know, keeping it very lean, almost having no budget, but really being, you know, running workshops for Cisco and WeWork and Pfizer, Audi, IBM, MBA programs in many different countries. So it's been an epic journey. And I guess just to sort of bring home a few more points is, while doing all this stuff, we got an email from Wiley's, which we didn't know. I was in Israel for 10 years and, you know, saying, hey, we're a big publishing company. We actually want you to write a book. We're just fascinated by the work that you do. And Ronen and I that day went online. We're like, is Wiley's based in Nigeria? And are they just trying to sort of get us to do something that, and we have to like do a little research. We go,
exactly.
This is real. And it was this sort of fascinating moment where like, oh my God, why would they ask us to write a book, right? You asked Warren Buffett to write a book after he made his first $1 billion. and ask Tony Robbins to write a book after he made his, massive self-development movement happen. We're still in the middle of the journey. How does that make sense? And it was sort of this realization that in the world we're living in, the new entrepreneurs are people who literally are the ones that are fascinating because they're living their journey and they don't want, they go through their life doing different things, and that's what's fun. That's what's shareable around the campfire. So essentially we wrote this book called The New Entrepreneurs about how to really, this new mindset of cool people that are just game changers in this new world that we're living in. You know, these are people like, the John Vromans that are running Front Row Foundations, giving people incredible experiences for sure. These are people like, I think about Paul Dunn that has a company called B1G1 where you can buy one, give one. But any company that wants to essentially partner with the opportunity to just give away, whenever you buy a product, right? So you buy a product and you get a letter in the mail saying, hey, thanks for buying that product. You just sponsored 40 kids in Ethiopia getting water for the next week. It's beautiful,
Yeah.
So it's an entire book basically around the new entrepreneurs, around people that are just changing things up. They're doing things differently.
Yeah.
And we talk a lot about it from the prism of our game. So it's very unique. And we have a digital game coming out soon. We were the first training company picked up by the Game Changers 500. So if you go to Game Changers 500, which is the new barometer for success in the new shared economy, you can see FreshBiz next to like Kickstarter, Etsy, Zappos for being a company with a mission, with impact. All this stuff is very sort of affirming because we very much believe in doing things passionately and working to elevate the conversation that people are having in the world of business, life, and lifestyle. And if I just had to, wrap up with a couple last things, I would just say that we're at a place right now where we're about 85% done with our digital game. IBM wants to partner with us. They have a serious games department. They want to partner with us to bring some AI into it to make it very robust, very enterprise level for companies that go through our workshop and want to continue playing digitally, which is pretty cool. And we're launching about 10 new countries for the start of 2016. In other words, we're licensing FreshBiz out to 10 amazing countries, top training companies in these countries. And we are going to be launching our FreshBiz Academy of online courses. So I know it's a whole lot of stuff.
Wow.
There's a lot of things after 5 years of building momentum that are really coming out at the same time.
Yeah. What I love is you get to the point with your friends where you literally can't keep up with their lives and what they're doing and all the exciting things. This happens so regularly for me where I talk with somebody and they share stuff like what you just said. And I'm like, no way. I have a million questions for you about all this. It's just so exciting. So first of all, congrats, man. And thanks for being somebody that's really making a difference in the world in such a positive and fun way. So creative. I often think to myself, if I were going to be stranded in the forest, like on a deserted island, I would definitely want you on my team. Like, because you're just such a resourceful person. You're always asking, how do we make this work? Or what's our opportunity here? You may be one of the best in the world at asking the question, where's the gift in this? Or, and I know you ask that in your own language and your own unique ways with the game, and we'll probably get to that a little bit here as well. But, it's just an awesome quality that you have, Sim, and people want to be around you because you are somebody that just adds so much to the conversation, adds so much. You bring so much to every interaction that you're with that people leave an interaction with you feeling elevated. So thank you for that.
Yeah, well, thank you for that. And we could always pull a Robinson Crusoe together whenever you'd like, my friend. It would be fun.
right. Oh, man. Those types of adventures are really fun, where you go out and you say, we're not going to take a map. We're just going to go explore and see what we can create on the spot or in the moment. Mm. I think it's life's improv, I think that's great. So, Sim, a couple of things here. One is, if you go back to, and you mentioned this, we played the game. I played the game. And I walked away from that experience having a profound transformational experience where immediately I could see how literally we played in my basement, in my office, and I walked upstairs. And the next thing that happened in my life, I don't even remember what it was. I remember how I felt though. And I just asked a new question. I said, I thought, what's an action card I can play here? It's some lingo, right, from the game. And it's like, how else could we approach this? How could this be a win, 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 win to the winth power, right? Mm. This started to have an immediate impact on my language internally and therefore externally. It was pretty powerful. So my question to you is, have you seen most commonly be the transformational breakthrough for people when they play the game? Like, is there a theme, I'm sure there is at this point, emerging from people saying this was the breakthrough the first time they played?
The answer is definitely yes. And I think just to take a step back for just a few seconds to just sort of add a part to it, which is more and more and more, you know, when you read articles, they're all talking about game-based learning. They're all talking about gamification. And just to make a distinction, you know, gamification is the idea of turning aspects of life into a game. So for example, you know, LinkedIn having 100% profile is a game that they play with people so that people put in more and more information so that they have quality accounts. So they've turned it into a game. So that's gamification, if you will. Game-based learning is the idea of learning through the experience of a game. And, you know, nowadays, especially nowadays, where millennials are flooding in and they're literally running companies, and essentially you have three or four different generations side by side by side in the same company, which is crazy. Millennials are all about experiences and they're all about, you know, that type of world. So you got to create enriching experiences. So what's fun being a training company that's not just a training company that's about motivation or rah-rah or about numbers and things like that specifically, but we're a training company that uses a game-based experience, is it does a few things. It really, it's not enough to know that collaboration is good. It's not enough to know that creativity is important. It's not about knowing it. You have to literally rewire your brain. You have to give muscle memory to your body in what being creative looks like to achieve a goal. You have to make it part of your DNA. You have to really get under the skin. It's almost like the equivalent of sort of like me knowing about the concept of gym and knowing about the concept of fitness and knowing, yeah, it's healthy. It's a good thing to actually, I go to the gym. It's part of my routine. I know how to use the machines. So our game essentially is like a game. It's like a fitness center for the mind. So people really are, they're rewiring their brain. They're putting collaboration, innovation, creativity. They're putting it into their muscle memory and they get really good at it. So the more you play it, the deeper you go. It's just that simple. You play the game, you get smarter, you move faster, you're better, you have a better cultural experience with your community because you have a similar language now and you had an experience together. So it really hammers things together. I guess specific, you know, successes that we've had from it, we've had, you know, on personal levels, on financial levels. I'll tell you, for example, running our workshops at WeWork, which is just an awesome shared workspace company that has about 45 locations now around the world. They're amazing. Running it for their community, for their shared space in Israel, they're right now actually working on putting together this community action card wall. Action card is sort of you know, all of your non-monetary currencies that we very often don't really think about, but we have so much of that if we just knew how to communicate them, if we just knew how valuable they could be when we use it or when someone else uses it, then we'd have a world that we can leverage that would get us just further and allow us to achieve our goals. So WeWork is right now working, at least the one in Israel, on putting together sort of like an action card wall for their community. They have so many people. And you know, can you just imagine if you had a shared workspace where a full wall of it was just what people's gifts, talents, skills, and abilities are, that you know that at any moment I can walk over to Kim from this company or I can walk over to John from here. John's amazing at SEO. Kim has an uncle that owns a restaurant. This person's got a connection at a record company. This person is the person that does this on Flipboard. And all of a sudden you can really weave together a success pattern. So that's pretty cool. We had Elvis.
That's awesome.
We had Elvis from Brazil. He actually runs a big, big training company down in São Paulo. And he went through our workshop playing the game. And for him, his big takeaway, there's a lot of different takeaways. It really just sort of, it shows up differently for different people based on what they need in their life. But his big takeaway about our game was the idea that access trumps ownership. In other words, it's more important that I have access to resources than I own them all. We live in a world where we just want access to music. We don't need to own all of our music. We want access to employees. We don't need to, you know, or to workers. We don't need to have them as employees. We can freelance them. We can ODesk them. We could do all different things. So he literally left our workshop. This guy went ahead and hearing about access trumps ownership, he sold his car because he realized I'm in the new shared economy. I could pretty much make money from selling my car. I could use Uber all over the place. And because São Paulo has the highest level of traffic almost in the world, on a day-to-day basis, this guy, Elvis, basically saves 2 to 3 hours of time that he's now working in the back of an Uber. And essentially, he's able to be more productive. He's able to nap there, set up appointments back there. He's making more money, got rid of his car, got rid of all the expenses around his car. That was just a really big move that he put together by himself from going through our workshop. And he essentially makes more, achieve lifestyle and ease. And that was a home run. Or, you know, just one more if it's, you know, if it's cool. We had this company. Good. So we had this company called RCS. They're based in Israel. They're pretty much one of the largest sellers of cell phones in the world. And they brought us in. You know, their sales manager said to me, she goes, I was debating if we're going to bring you in or if we were just going to take our team out on a yacht for a fun day. I'm like, well, hopefully you'll be happy that you chose us and not the yacht. It's like, in the end, they're so happy. I fly back in 3 weeks and she's having me run another workshop for a different team to start the new year off. But basically, they went ahead and her sales team loved the idea and the game. We talk about, you know, in life, sometimes you're rolling the die in life. You're trying new things. You're doing different things. And sometimes in life, you need to roll that six. Like you need this to happen. You got to roll that six. And, you know, one of the things that we need to realize is that in life, you know, if you need a six in life, just roll 1,000 dice, you know. You can't always do that, but you can look for ways to roll 1,000 dice. You'll guarantee that you get the six. You'll guarantee success. And their salespeople just love the idea of, wow, how can I roll 1,000 dice on a weekly basis so that I get six after six after six? I get close after, you know, I get sale after sale after sale. And now they're pretty much all speak the language of, well, how do we throw more dice? What can we do to throw more dice? And their sales have exploded. I mean, their sales have literally exploded. And now I'm coming back in 3 weeks to take a different team through the same process. So that was just like a home run. I mean, that was just an exciting home run to read their testimonial, really hear their feedback, really hear how just a metaphor, you know, a metaphor played out through the game has been a real takeaway for their entire sales team. We had a hotel chain called Fatal. They're like the largest in Israel. They have 52 hotels around the country. And we took all their hotel managers basically through a game-based experience also. Just because David Fatal, who's the CEO, he wanted everybody, you know, he wanted each hotel manager to feel like an entrepreneur of their own small business, of each one being the owner, if you will, of a hotel. And we did it and we nailed it. And his HR manager had each person afterwards, you know, fill out a whole proposal of just one idea that they got that they could implement from playing FreshBiz. And the first idea that they looked at out of 52 different ideas that they collected was an idea about how they can essentially refurbish a section of the hotel by looking at it from a different perspective. And in the end, they asked for a budget of $200,000 and they made $1 million over the last 24 months. And they're going to continue to make $500,000 every single year going forward for the rest of their lives from this one idea, from one manager, from this workshop that we did. So we've been brought back since. We do a lot of stuff with them and they're...
Clearly. Yeah. Dude, that's awesome. Those are big takeaways, man. I want to go back and highlight. I mean, talking about the action cards, and I don't want to, maybe you can redefine it for us again. So the action cards are the strengths, the talents, the resources that you have access to. Is that how you would define that?
Yeah, exactly.
Like, you know, what would be an action card for you as an example?
An action card for me, well, I'll tell you, is an action card for me is knowing that I was going to be traveling and training around the world for the past couple of months. I had an open apartment in Jerusalem, and because Rach and I are healthy people, so we had, you know, we have our Vitamix, we have our juicers, we have all that stuff over there, and sort of keeping it empty is very sad. You know, we want to really be able to share it. So we put it up on Airbnb. We found this amazing family from Australia that's super healthy and love the fact that we had all that stuff. We basically rented it out for them for 6 weeks, and that was a home run for us financially. It was a home run for them because they got a great place to stay at. And it was just very cool, just sort of taking advantage of one of these new shared economy things that we can. So that was an action card for us, having an empty home.
Dude, I want to put it out there, Sim. We've never said this, but dude, if we ever can sync our schedules up, dude, you should come here and we should go there and we should somehow swap houses. That would be great. That would be really fun.
I'm in. Yeah. It'll allow me to work out of the Front Row Foundation area.
That's
over
right.
There.
That's it, man. We're set up. We set you up for success here. I also want to mention, so the access trumps ownership is huge. That is definitely a shift for me. And I think that anybody listening today could get that immediately and think about how does that apply in their life starting today? You know, where might they be able to let go of some things that they think they have to own that's old school thinking? And think about also being grateful for and recognizing the power of the access they currently have. So, you know, for me, and one of the action cards that I've played recently with you is access to individuals that I was then making introductions. I think that's a great action card to play for anybody listening right now also, is just to create some introductions between people that could benefit from knowing one another. And I think that's a huge way. Put people in proximity of each other. Put people into one another's front row. That I think is critical. And I also I love that if you need to roll a six, just roll 1,000 dice. I mean, that makes so much sense, right? And what I think that phrase screams is hope. Because it says, you know, there is, if you just keep putting one foot in front of the other, you'll get there. You know, if the universe hasn't conspired yet to give you that six, it will if you keep rolling the dice, you know, and I think that's great.
Beautiful.
Yeah, it's wonderful, man. Sim, to ask you a question that you ask so many others, what game are you currently playing and what does winning look like for you?
Oh, no, he didn't.
I was like, I can't wait to ask him this question.
Oh, man, beautiful. Okay, great. What game am I playing and what does winning look like? Wow. Well, the game that I'm playing is a game of highly impacting people to really change the way that they play life, to have a different set of skills, tools, and mindset so that we can do what we call multidimensional winning. I really believe that the world can be a richer place. And I don't mean just on a financial level because that's such a one-dimensional sort of conversation. I mean on a multidimensional conversation. The world can be a richer place if people just really can think differently, if we can work together better, if we can really understand how to unlock creativity and innovation, and we can weave the right aspects together. And like what you said, you know, create the right partnerships or the right connections for people. Why? Just because. Because we know it's going to be better for the world. So the game I'm playing is to do that on a very large scale. I really would like to be able to, you know, impact over 10 million people over the next 24 months around the globe, upgrading their conversation, giving them new language and distinctions, making them view business and the world as a game, because things are a lot more fun when you're playing a game than when you're just showing up to work.
There's no doubt.
And I believe that that's really going to unlock humanity. That's the game I'm playing. And an additional game that I'm playing while I'm doing that is, you know, I'm married now for 15 years. It took Rachel and I about 12 years to have our first baby. So you talk about holding on to hope and holding on to prayer and, wow, and divinity. And we've definitely been through a journey and stuff. So I'm playing that game as I'm living a family-centric life, because it's very important. I love my family. I have a 2-year-old. I have a 5-month-old, and I love my family. So I'm really working on playing on a large stage, but at the same time, still having very rich family experiences, bringing them along for the journey, including them, doing great stuff with them, because family is a very important lifestyle choice. And what winning looks like, you know, literally just waking up every day, family, being able to be with John Vroman on a podcast, being able to be later on in the week with a large organization impacting 150 leaders from around the world, just really just essentially doing what I do and celebrating those wins. Because I know that essentially, you know, a big win is nice, but essentially lots of small wins also add up to a big win.
Right.
And, you know, these past 5 years, we've been very patient. We've been very early for a while, but things are really starting to catch up. Momentum is just totally here and it's just beautiful. So winning the game looks like just showing up every day, coming from a place of service, from a place of what else can I offer? I'm just going to put this out there. You know, we're sort of in a world now where everyone wants to be an expert. Everyone, you know, it's this whole thing of expertology. You know, everyone wants to be an expert. And part of, in my mind, what's important for me is to never be an expert. It's to always be evolving myself and always be pivoting and shifting and learning and just from my heart, having my heart open and, you know, just being part of the journey and sharing it, figuring out what it means. How can I help this be something great for more people? So that's it.
Wow. What a radical shift in some thinking, by the way, with the, you know, the idea of I don't want to be an expert. I want to always be a student in so many words. You know, I know I'm changing what you just said, but that's how I interpreted it, right? It's like, yeah, sometimes we get so obsessed, and I think that's very significance driven in many ways, or maybe it's driven by marketing needs, but the idea of, you know, and I get you could argue the definition and the point, but the idea of remaining a student is really powerful.
Yeah.
Sim, dude, a 2-year-old and a 5-month-old? Oh my goodness. you really are playing a game there, balancing all this with the travel and the business and your family. But what I can attest to, which I think is great, is I witness, you know, your life with your family. And you really are doing a great job. I think your kids would be very proud of how you're living your life right now when they learn about it down the road a little bit more, which is great.
Thanks. Thanks.
Sim, I want to get into really a core part of our interview here, and that is exploring maybe a deeper moment in life where you had a transformation. You went from back row to front row. And the thing I want to clarify with this, I think it's really important, I weave this in occasionally to people. So I'm saying this as much for the community as just something fun for us to chat about, is that there are benefits of the back row. You know, the benefit of having perspective or being close to the exit, and, you know, not always is the best seat in the house up front. And the front row can be intimidating at times. It can be crowded. It can be not the most comfortable place to be. It's not the easiest to get to the bathrooms from the front row. But there's no doubt that being in proximity to something of power is a different experience of life. And that if we want to really create a difference in our world, we have to get engaged with it. So a lot of times living a front row life is about engagement. It's the way we play the game in that moment where we have to step up and get a little uncomfortable at times to be able to play and be a little bit more vulnerable where everybody can see us, but we might not be able to see them. That's a vulnerable position. What comes to mind for you as one of those transformative back row to front row moments of your life that you could share with us?
First off, that was beautiful. I really loved hearing how you defined it and really put a lot of perspective on it. What I'd say has been truly transformational in my life was Rachel and I. You know, I grew up in New York. Rachel grew up in New Jersey. We were pretty much young executives running a big sales company, and we were making great money. And back then, our only barometer for success was about making money. And just that's just how it was. I mean, that's just, you know, we were really young. I was out of college. It was about having a good job or having a good, you know, business and making a lot of money. And we were making a lot of money, but we were killing ourselves. You know, we were working our butts off. We were feeling frustrated. I wasn't sure if Rachel and I were business partners or if we were husband and wife or if we were both and what that actually looked. So it was just sort of this blurred area for a while. And I remember doing our first real self-development workshop over the course of a weekend. A fellow manager had recommended it to us just because he got so much value from it. And he's like, you'll make more money if you go do it. And I'm so happy he said that because that was our only barometer for why we would ever give up our personal time, was only if we'd make more money. And we wound up doing this self-development weekend, if you will. And I wound up literally changing our lives. I mean, I got relationships back. I let go of a lot of hurt and frustration that I had from my childhood. It really unlocked a tremendous amount of things inside myself for Rachel and I as a husband and wife, a lot. And I think that was the first, and before that I had done a lot of sort of sales development stuff and had to close better and had to pitch better and had to recruit better and had to convince better and had to sit. But that's not the same thing. I'm talking about real self-development just for the purpose of unlocking oneself. And pretty much after doing it, you know, we did make more money. We actually had our first $1 million year as an office, which was just awesome. And we won a whole bunch of stuff. But within 12 months of going through that weekend, we essentially, you know, started asking the question of, well, you know, look, we're two Jewish people, you know, living in New York. Well, we've been doing the American dream. What does the Jewish dream look like? What does that mean for us? And it means, you know, what it meant for us was it meant Israel. It meant being in the startup nation, you know, the nation that creates things like Waze, right? So it meant like that's a cool place. And it's challenging and it's got its own set of challenges for sure. But within 12 months, we literally banged out a big year. We sold our house, cars, and business, and we moved there. And we had just, you know, we had a little bit of a sense of what we might do there, but it was totally from a place of faith, totally from a place of going, all right, you know, I don't know what it's going to look like in the front row, but I know I want to be there. I know I want to be there. I know it's going to be awesome. And, you know, I like what you said, that there's different set of risks when you're front row, back row. It's not good or bad. And sometimes you could be here and sometimes you could be there. There's a really good book by Price Pritchett called U Squared. He talks about this idea, this fantasy that people think that they're either going to go from safety to unsafety. But the reality is it's always about choosing a new set of risks. There's risks wherever you are, no matter what the heck the risks are. So for us, that was really our front row experience, was about a decade ago, 10 years ago, moving to Israel, to the startup nation, and recreating ourselves and learning a new language and figuring it out, being in the Middle East, having security challenges sometimes. But it's been such a blessing. I've never looked back. You know, since we got to Israel, we've literally built big real estate careers over there. I had a radio show for a while. Some of my friends are some of the top influencers in all the startup nation. Literally, you know, it's been a place where I met Ronen. We got to found FreshBiz, and pretty much now Israel's our home, but we travel and train around the world. And that really, for me, would be, you know, would be the the back row to front row transition and transformation.
Sim, I remember when I remember hearing that you were going to move to Israel. And I can almost remember exactly what I was thinking or feeling at the time. And if I were to paraphrase, it would just be like, what? They're moving to Israel? Like literally? Like permanently? Like not for a week vacation? I remember having this like, it was a shock to my system. And what it was, I was inquisitive, and then I was like, wow, what courage, how exciting, what an adventure. How broad must their thinking be to have considered that option and then to have really pulled that off? Massive shift or transformation. I've always been really drawn to change and people that have the ability to change. Like one of my favorite quotes of all time from one of our great mentors, somebody we both, I know, acknowledge as a great leader, Tony Robbins said, "Our biography is not our destiny." Mm. That quote could have been one of the most profound quotes in my life, you know, that my past does not have to be my future.
I love it.
And, you know, you go to this event and you start thinking about your life and you ask yourself some tough questions and you start thinking about what does ideal look like for you? What is a, you know, oh yeah, versus a, yeah, maybe. It's like, what says yes? Like that's what we're going to do. And I think you've chosen courageously throughout your life and it's led to some really awesome opportunities. I also love the book U Squared. That's a really tiny book, right?
It's a really tiny book.
Tiny book, silver. It's like, Hal Elrod gave that to me. And choose a new set of risks. Is that what you said from that?
Exactly.
Yeah, choose a new set of risks. Really profound. Really cool. So many questions I'd have about this transformation, but here's one.
Can I just add one more thing, if that's okay?
Yeah, please add.
Just because, you know, very often we talk about we peak our life, we share highlights, you know, we like to peak things on social media and you don't really often hear about all the, you know, all the struggles and stuff. You know, it definitely wasn't easy going to Israel. I want to just put this out there, which was, you know, pretty much I thought that I was going to be working for this big coaching company, making good money over there. And then within about a week of getting there, they closed down the entire operation. They like literally dismantled everything. And I was going, are you serious? And then I had this great idea in the shower one day about the fact that here I am as someone who's in a new place and I love health and wellness, but there is no one website resource for everybody for the world of health and wellness. So I created what was called Israel Green Pages. It was going to be like the yellow pages for the health and wellness. And this is back, you know, again, when the internet was still, you know, you needed to pay someone to build a website. It wasn't so accessible. And I pretty much spent about $12,000 and about 15 months of my life working with a company that wound up declaring bankruptcy and leaving me with absolutely nothing of what I got. And I remember looking up at the heavens going, are you freaking kidding me that this is going on? I left top in the US at what I was doing to go ahead and be devastated and crushed. Are you kidding me? And it was just, you know, things don't always work out, but it's a matter of just being in the game. And, you know, I think about that all, you know, all the time, that 80% of success is simply showing up. And my goal was to just keep showing up. And thank God things really evolved past that and whatever else. But I wanted to just put that out there that, it, you know, it's not always a smooth ride. Transitions never really are. The goal is to just be as graceful as you can during them.
That's right. Yeah. Yeah. So true, man. Sim, along the lines of this transition, talk about this for just another minute or two. Who was most influential in supporting you during this transition when you were taking this big leap? Can you recall people that... or one person in particular that was influential, and how were they such a mentor for you?
Well, definitely built an accountability between Rachel and I was definitely helpful, but really both of our parents were, I should say, both of our families. You know, obviously it's a little bit of like a zero sum game, because essentially us moving somewhere else means that we're not near them, so it's hard to be excited for someone when they're moving away from you. But they really were so selfless about it. They just were just, you know, proud of us. They were excited for us. They were just inspired by what it meant. And they just loved us through it, which was really nice. You know, we each had a couple of friends that lived, you know, in Tel Aviv, in Jerusalem, that greeted us, that essentially introduced us to their networks of people. That was very helpful. It made us feel less sort of like by ourselves in a new place. But I'd say just family and really close friends was very key.
That's great. Perfect time to transition. I want to get into parenting for a second. We have a lot of listeners in this show who are great parents and want to be even better parents. For your kids, both 2 and 5 months old now, what do you believe are 2 experiences that your children must have in life?
Oh my goodness. Wow. That's a great question.
Those are my favorite words to hear.
You're like, that's how I know I got that.
That's it. I told you at the beginning part of the interview, as I do everybody, I'm like, hey, I might throw you a curveball here today. I'm going to ask some pretty interesting questions.
What are 2 experiences that they must have, huh? Well, yeah. I'm going to answer one on a more general level. One is the...
Aside from playing FreshBiz, of course.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, of course. I'm going to answer one like this. One is definitely global travel. Whatever space, whatever country, however long that looks like, and we're going to have a chance to travel a lot together. But I just know that global travel, it expands a person's mind. It expands thinking. It allows everything to just, I mean, it's a totally new world out there. So I definitely would like my kids to be able to appreciate the richness of the world by actually seeing it, not just by watching it on National Geographic, which is beautiful and we love, not just going to the zoo, but like really going to places where you might not ever think to go there, but it's just so expanding when you do. So I'd say one would definitely be travel. I don't have a specific place in mind, pardon me, but definitely would be traveling experiences. And what would be the second experience?
It's a great first answer. And I'll use this as an opportunity to compliment you and pause and let you get time to think. But that is something I definitely agree with is travel. And for me, as a child, my dad was military. And we had an opportunity to get overseas a couple of times at a fairly young age. I want to say 10, 12, 15, I remember getting out and traveling. And that had a profound impact on me, especially being able to see parts of the world that were not as well off.
Beautiful. I guess the second one also, and if you're looking for something crazy, I am pretty crazy, but not in this moment am I going to show up like that. I think that the second answer would just be that, you know, I would very much want them doing seminars, doing trainings that really help unlock them to be better humans. Because I mean, it's just really, I think of that quote about how you do anything is how you do everything in life. And I think that the more unlocked we as people are, it just shows up in every single aspect and every single dimension of our life. And I just want them to be able to just be bold and comfortable and to make big moves and not have to, you know, be thinking about, well, what if it doesn't work out? And really listening to that, you know, that fear in their head or like, you know, that sort of story in their head, why they can't do something, why they're not good enough, why they need to wait a little bit, why they need to look for approval as opposed to opportunity. So I think it would be a combination of travel and self-development and as just core parts of their identity of who they are. And I just sort of trust that everything else will turn out amazing if they really have that at their essence.
Hey, how cool is, by the way, this is such a compliment to you, Sim, that you're so authentic because, you know, what you want for your children is for them to go through trainings and seminars. And I joked about them playing the game, but this is what I think in my mind about my children is I hope that Tony Robbins is still doing UPW when my kids grow up because I really want them to go. That's how you know that you really believe in something, right? You want your children to have those same experiences. I'm totally with you that the opportunity to retreat, the opportunity to connect with great mentors or leaders or teachers, people that can deliver great information in a way that we get it, you know? I remember going to a couple of events in my life where I thought, nobody in my life that I've known throughout my whole life has delivered information in a way that I would get it like I'm getting it here.
Wow.
And maybe it's just, it's because I've chosen to be here. Maybe it's because it was a certain immersion type experience that I hadn't had. It's, people have been telling me that maybe all my life, but I didn't hear it because I wasn't in the right frame. I don't know. But that is such a transformative experience. And I think we share that passion for wanting to create experiences for people, both in our businesses and in our families, that allow them to transform. You know, I think that's really critical.
Yeah. You know, just to put this out there, I had such a proud moment as a father. I came back, I was in Vietnam and Thailand for about 2 weeks in total, and I really missed my family. And then I traveled back to Israel before traveling back to the US. Anyways, I get back here and I see my oldest, my son, Maor, who's 2. And you know, we're just big hugs. We're fired up to play together. And then at one point he says something and then he stops. He looks at me and he says, We don't say, I can't. I can't say I can't. I say, can you help me? And I said, yes, exactly. And we hadn't even talked about that for a month, but it was just such a powerful message for him that we don't say we can't. We ask for either help or we say, how can I? And that the fact that this 2-year-old kid is bringing up this memory that he had from a month ago and I haven't seen him in 3 weeks. And that was his, I was just melted, man. I just got tears in my eyes. I just was so excited.
Proud papa moment right there.
Oh, big time.
That's awesome. Sim, I want to transition here into two kind of final questions of our main interview. And then I've got a little bit of a rapid fire question round for you here at the end.
Sure.
But, you know, as you know, in the charity, we serve people who are battling life-threatening illnesses. And so death is something that a lot of people that we work with address in their lives, and sometimes much earlier than we probably should have to. At 10, you know, to 15, 20, 30 years old and so on, we've worked with people of all different ages. I particularly, when I've addressed my own mortality in life, have gained some great inspiration from thinking that this is a temporary ride and knowing that this day counts and that there's not anything that I'm going to do today that somebody else at some point in the history of the world wasn't doing when it was their last day. And so what I want to ask you about is, how do you process death and how do you find light in that sometimes very dark topic?
That's a great question. What I would answer is like this. I think that from an interesting perspective, I think that it's actually never been easier to be comfortable with the idea of death than nowadays. And the reason I'm saying that is because what's actually interesting is I feel like in 2015, the idea of death is a lot easier maybe to be with than it's ever been before. And I'm saying this because we live in such a time where we literally have no idea what's going to be around in 6 months from now or a year from now. The technology is so quick. Things are moving so fast. Culturally, things are shifting so much. You know, 50, 60 years ago, it really wasn't like that. You knew exactly where you were going to be for your entire life, company, family, location-wise. And nowadays, we're just on this journey of the world just shifting. There's so much unknown out there, John. There's so much unknown out there that literally, you can only get to a place where you realize, look, if I have no control, then I just really have day by day influence in making good choices. That's it. And I'm not scared of death. For me, as someone who sees life as a game, and that's definitely the message of FreshBiz, death is simply when your time has run out. And my goal is to play the game and to have fun and to help a lot of people win their games along the way. And when my time is up, my time is up. Thank you for having me. Thank you for letting me play. It's been a privilege. It's been an honor. You know, not only has it been a privilege and honor to play, but in 2015 to play with some of the highest level tools and resources we've literally ever had at humanity's fingertips to be able to play with. So I view it as a privilege and as a pleasure. And I think knowing that in this new shared economy, we literally have no idea what's around the corner. Okay. I'm talking about on the side of light. And definitely, unfortunately, on the side of darkness with what's happening around the world. We have no idea. So if we have no idea, the only thing I could take comfort in is my family, my life choices, and on the day-to-day. And I think, you know, it's very easy to say, well, just let's take it one day at a time, right? But really, let's take it one day at a time. You know, let's focus on winning the day every single day because that's all we got. And I appreciate that. I fully own it. I fully get it. And that's why I find it, you know, I don't find it scary. I wish I knew when the time was going to end, right? In the game of FreshBiz, you know when the time's going to end. But at the same time, you know, so much is beyond our control nowadays that it's just sort of one more thing beyond our control. So let's just make good choices.
Yeah. All right. I got a deep one for you. And then I'll lighten it up real quick, I promise. But the deep one is if your children only get access to what you say next, and you have 30 seconds to tell them something about life, and this is what they get. What do you say to your kids when you have 30 seconds of airtime?
Oh my gosh. Well, I would definitely quote Yogi Berra, who says, you know, when you come to a fork in the road of life, take it, because I love that. And I think just take it, trust yourself, trust that you know that you have what it takes. And if you don't have what it takes, trust that you can tap into the right people and the right resources that do have what it takes to be able to win at whatever you want to do. and just explore and have fun and make it count.
Wow, great advice, man. I think I'll play that for my kids and just say that I said it.
Okay, no problem.
That's really good, man. That's really good. Sim, something actionable for our group. We do have a group that likes to live life in the front row here. So what's one thing that you'd suggest that they might try in the next 24 hours to live a front row life?
Okay, good. I would definitely say try on the concept of throwing 1,000 dice. You know, if you need to accomplish success in your life, so, you know, you send 1,000 emails, you connect with 1,000 people on LinkedIn, however long it takes you, you reach out to 1,000 people, you know, you can't get that wrong. It's like that quote, right? You can't say the wrong thing to the right person. Well, you do 1,000 actions, you throw 1,000 dice, you're going to get a 6. And I'd say that that's definitely something tangible and actionable that somebody can certainly try out or can certainly play with. Very much so. And I would also say, you know, focus on sowing the right seeds, you know, focus on putting the right actions in play so that essentially, just like in the game, you know, essentially you'll get to a place where you can really collect profits and it'll be really substantial. And when I use the term profits, I really, again, I don't just mean money. That's like so critical to say. Profits in every aspect. Again, we're multidimensional creatures. We've never wanted to win so many different aspects of our life and of our game. I'm talking about winning professionally, winning a lifestyle, winning family-wise, winning health-wise, all that stuff. So I think it's just really focus on planting really good seeds so that you could essentially reap and collect profits with great people as often as you possibly can. And very often we don't know what those actions are, but just take some action and you'll see.
Right. Yeah, that's great. Sim, this has been awesome, buddy. I so appreciate all these answers and your heart and soul that you've shared today. I know that you're going to have a lot of new raving fans after this interview, and hopefully a bunch of people who will be ready to play the FreshBiz game. I want to wrap things up here with just a couple of fun, you know, questions. Kind of get to know you a little bit more as we kind of sign off here today. These are questions that I want to challenge you to answer in either one word or maximum one sentence. Go with your gut, speak from the heart. One word, one sentence. You've never heard these before. Are you ready?
Let's do it, baby.
All right. So who's your biggest fan?
My family.
Okay. Who has been one of your greatest mentors in life?
My partner, Ronen.
Who would you crawl through glass for?
My family.
I knew it. I could have predicted that.
Yeah.
Good answer, buddy. Who is one of your dream clients that you haven't worked with, but you can't wait to?
Google and Facebook.
All right. Front row community, you've heard it. That is your mission to make this introduction possible. Play an action card, baby. Play an action card.
Let's do it.
What does it mean to you to be fully alive?
Unknown exhilaration.
Unknown exhilaration. Wow, that's great. I'm definitely going to use that and quote myself. Just kidding.
I'm gonna be so smart after this.
This is great.
Damn it.
What are three things that you're grateful for right now?
I'm grateful for making good choices with a good company the past 5 years. I'm grateful for seeing divinity, magic, and miracles in the world. It keeps me light, keeps me humble, and keeps me sober. And I'm grateful for all the family and connections I have in my life. Every one of them has been just amazing. And if it hasn't served me yet, it's going to serve me eventually. And just whoever is in my life right now has just been a gift.
Sim, what's one of the first happiest memories that you can recall?
It would be in Newport News, Virginia, with my parents, feeding the ducks.
Do you know how old you were?
I was 3.
Wow, really?
Yeah.
That's amazing. That's incredible. 3 years old. It's so wild to think that, that you know, in 1 year, by the way, your child could be having memories that he'll be recalling for so long in his life. That's wild.
Yeah.
All right. When you get sad, what's it usually about?
Feeling like I don't matter. Feeling like I wish I had more control over making something happen when I don't. And wanting to be okay with it, but not always being okay with it.
Yeah. Well, buddy, you matter to us a lot. And we love you.
Thanks.
If you had to switch brains with someone for a day, who would you pick?
Richard Branson, the entrepreneur is entrepreneur.
Yes, Great choice. All right, one of my favorite questions. What's something fun that you've collected in your lifetime?
Ooh, that's a cool question. Well, again, access trumps ownership. So it used to be that I needed something from different places I went to, but I've just become really just so happy having access to great pictures and taking great shots. But what's one thing I've collected from somewhere really special? Well, you'll appreciate this because you're a Jason Mraz fan like I am. I went to one of his shows. I had this like epic night where I literally managed to get backstage to cut an entire line and to take a picture with him, with the two of us wearing our hats, making fishy faces. And I have it in my office. And that's just a fun collectible for me. Just being someone who loves music, loves concerts, and loves Jason Mraz. That just lives as a collectible for me forever.
That's awesome, man. We both have good Mraz stories. And you know, and I'll tell the community that in case they don't know, so for the Front Row Foundation, as you know, and I'll share with everybody else in case they don't know, I was at a Jason Mraz show when the idea of being in the front row first hit me. This was 2005 on my birthday, June 14th, in Philadelphia. And I was in the very back row, and I saw this group of ladies having a great time in the front row, standing up, dancing, singing, shouting out requests. And that's when the idea hit me. So Jason Mraz has been had a special place in both of our hearts, and all that sounds very, very not so masculine, I should say. It's true, right? It's a guy who's really been inspiring, I think, to both of us, and I think that's really cool.
I will never be embarrassed with a bromance of someone who, in my mind, is like my vocal role model. Yeah. I'm not going to apologize. I don't care.
He's amazing. So final question for you, Sim, and thanks for being so generous with your time today. Dude, I've really enjoyed this interview. This has been just so much fun. If you could be, on the topic of music, or, by the way, this is any event, be front row to any event, any place, anywhere in the world, who or what would you see? And as a bonus, where would you see him?
Okay. Well, if I had to be front row at a show, it would either be for something like Led Zeppelin or, let's say, John Mayer. I love John Mayer as a musician, as a guitar player. I'd love to be front row for a John Mayer concert. I don't have any specifics as to where it would need to be. I just know where I would need to be. I'd need to be front row because he's such a talented guitar player. That would be my front row experience. I had a front row experience with the Red Hot Chili Peppers back in Tel Aviv. That was epic.
Oh, that's cool.
So that one's crossed off the list, if you will.
Hey, but didn't John Mayer just partner up with like some members of the Dead?
And did, yeah,
that's really cool.
That's awesome, is what that is.
Yeah, maybe we'll have to put that on our dreams list, buddy, and make that happen.
Amen.
That's cool. So, Sim, I'm going to let you get back to your day. I know you've got a lot of fun things happening, and I want to say thanks again for this entire conversation. Where do people go to get more about FreshBiz or about you, about what you're up to?
Sure. Well, I'm on social media. My name is Simcha, S-I-M-C-H-A, Gluck. And definitely go on to Amazon. Check out the new Entrepreneurs with a Z at the end. And get it. It's on Audible. It's on Amazon. It's just such a good read, such a good book. And send me, you know, your feedback. Leave a review. You can check out our website, freshbizgame.com. And we also have a pretty good group on Facebook as well. And if there's any way that we can run a workshop for your community, your team, or open up a country for where you're at, where you live, I'd be open to that conversation. My partner, Ronen Gafni, G-A-F-N-I. We're on LinkedIn. We're on Facebook. So we're happy to be able to be a resource for whoever would like to reach out.
Sim, this has been so cool, man. And I want to tell everybody that your book really is remarkable. I listened to the entire book on a run that I did last weekend at one take, the entire thing. I think it was 5.5 hours.
Oh my God.
That was a lot of Sim. You read the book and it was great because you have a great voice and the tempo was perfect. But the content and the information and just, it's like, you know, one of those books where I'm listening and I'm thinking, this is for me. Now, here's the thing. I have to, full disclosure here. I'm in the book. You write about me in the book. And so I'm very appreciative of that. Beside from that, which I'm always like, now, am I allowed to pitch his book knowing that I'm in it? Does it sound like I'm trying to pitch myself? But I genuinely, really mean that this book is awesome because it does speak to my heart, man. We are from the same tribe of people who believe that we can all be creative in solving the world's greatest problems, and we can all live fully, you know, through this experience. And so I'm just so pumped for you, man. I want to say thank you for helping shape a world that my boys are growing up in. I really am appreciative that you are on Team Human and that you're making the impact that you are. You've been a great friend for over a decade. I've been front row to your journey. I've been so blessed to be connecting to you when you're back in the States and when we're on the phone chatting, to get these incredible updates about the progress that you're making and the fun that you're having. And it really does inspire me. You're one of those people for me, Sim, that I don't feel jealous of. I feel inspired by, because you lift other people up. That is one of your talents and your skills. And it's something that you were born to do, is to lift people up that are around you. And so whenever you rise, all those that are around you in your front row, they rise too. And so I feel blessed to be one of those people. I love you, brother. I think you're great. My best to Rachel and your children. And I can't wait to see you whenever our cross can pass, you know, down the road. I'm so grateful for that time, both now and in the future. So all my best to you, buddy. Love you. And can't wait to talk to you again.
Thank you so much.
All right, everybody. I hope you enjoyed that chat with Mr. Sim Gluck. I got so many awesome takeaways from that conversation. Also, if you want to connect with Sim, you can find his game online at freshbizgame.com. That's B-I-Z. And you can also get his book, The New Entrepreneurs, with a Z at the end, on Amazon. His encore episode, which is Questions from You, the Community, will be available in just a couple of days here. And if you want to ask questions to future guests, make sure to join our Facebook group. You can get there by going to frontrowfriends.com, and there I'll post who I'm going to be interviewing in the coming days and weeks, and you can tell me what questions you'd like to ask. If you're enjoying the show, please, we'd love for you to share it with your friends. We love seeing your ratings and reviews online. If you're listening to this on your phone, you can just click on my face on the icon there. It'll open up the show notes, and there's a spot where you can click rate and review, and that's the best way that you can help us to continue to get this show out to more people, is by helping to lift it up to the top of the rankings so that more people can find us. And we want to thank you for the love and support. Thanks for all your ideas and suggestions on how we can continue to grow and get better and deliver more value for you. So that's it for today, everybody. Can't wait until next time. If you want to find more, go to frontrowfactor.com. You can also get our 4 minutes in the Front Row weekly email delivered right to your inbox. Until next time, keep living your life in the front row.
That's all for this episode of The Front Row Factor. To discover more simple and effective ways to lead a fearless front row life, please visit frontrowfactor.com and subscribe to John's 4 Minutes in the Front Row, where he shares quick stories from real life experiences. Thanks again for joining us today. We hope our show inspires you to live big, give big, and experience life to the fullest. See you next time on The Front Row Factor.